गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू. आई डॉक्टर दिनेश वाघेला, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ शांतिलाल शाह इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज. आई वार्मली वेलकम यू ऑल, आवर रिस्पेक्टेड प्रिंसिपल सर, आवर रिस्पेक्टेड हेड ऑफ डिपार्टमेंट, ऑल माई डियर कलीग्स एंड ऑल डियर पार्टिसिपेंट्स इन दिस टूडेज वेबिनार ऑन रिग्रेशन इन मशीन लर्निंग यूजिंग पाइथन प्रोग्रामिंग. Dear friends, as you know, nowadays machine learning is the most emerging field of artificial intelligence, and there are lots of research scope in different application domains, like we can say weather forecasting, product recommendations, online fraud detection, self-driving cars, quality control and quality assurance in the production, and lot many applications we can use regression and machine learning concept. Regression is analysis is one of the machine learning method which allows us to predict continuous outcome based on one or more multiple predictor variables. So dear friends, today we are having an opportunity to get the knowledge of our expert. But before starting the session, I would like to welcome our most dynamic and active principal sir, who has given the motivation, always giving a motivation to all of us. And due to that, we are only here and we are gathered in this particular webinar. So I request our respected principal sir, please share your motivating words to us, sir.
Thank you, Dinesh. Thank you, Dinesh. Very good morning to one and all, and thanks to the Department of Information Technology and the faculty members to give me an opportunity to connect in this event in this wonderful morning. Probably this is the first day, active day, with classes opening physically. So since 1.5 years, all of us were connected virtually online. But there is a good sign that if this continues, physical classes continues normally, and we hope that it happens, all of us will be more comfortable as we were previously to this pandemic situation. And of course, that situation has helped us a lot to make changes and to improve in the way we operate. And this webinar series conducted, this is a second one, as the students may be knowing, that we are able to connect with lot many outside experts, like one who is going to share his expertise today, Dr. Uday Sangh. And I'm looking forward to lot many more events like this. The change which I see having this kind of events for the student especially is that, otherwise, when the classes were running physically, you were having interaction with your department teachers, and at times the examiners who come to examine you at the end of the term. But this is a platform which gets you connected with different kind of people across the state and nation, even many a times out of the country. And that helps us that learning part is different for different locations in the globe. And that helps us a lot. It is possible that many of you or few of you may be looking for your master's in BVM, and the same person who is expert today may be your guide someday. Similar kind of what we call is networking. Networking is very much possible using this platform, and information technology is field to create networks among various disciplines. See, people say that information technology is not a standalone discipline in its own, but this is a discipline or a branch, information technology, which connects all the other engineering or even non-engineering faculties so that the common benefits can be made available to the public in large. I am not expert, or I am not much known about the topic today, but I am very sure that your faculty members and the experts will do the justice and take you to a ride which will be quite useful, quite encouraging and motivating to learn further in the area of information technology. I congratulate again the organizers, the head of the department and faculty members, as well as the students, and especially very much heartily thank the today's speaker for sharing his time and making this event possible. So not taking much time, I would like to wish a very successful event today. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, sir. I also thankful to our head of department, Dr. Milind sir, who has always guided us to organize the such kind of webinars and other technical events. Now, without wasting a lot many times, let me first introduce to our today's speaker. So now today we are having an opportunity to acquire the knowledge of today's topic from Dr. Udesan K. Jalia, who is an assistant professor in computer engineering department of Birla Vishwakarma Mahavidyalay. He has more than 18 years of teaching experience, and his research areas are in machine learning and image processing. Sir has published more than 50 research papers and three books in international journals and conferences. He has delivered expert talks in more than 20 technical events. Currently, he is guiding four PhD scholars, and he is the DPC member in a couple of PhD scholars. So I heartily welcome to Dr. Udesan Jalia sir in this particular webinar, and I request him to share his valuable knowledge in this particular webinar. Udesan Jalia sir, please.
Thank you, sir. I am very thankful to Principal Sirs, Head of Department Milind Sir, and Coordinators Dinesh Sir and Bhavesh Sir for giving me this opportunity. So without taking much time, we will start the presentations. So I am sharing the screen. So good morning to all. So today's talk is on regression in machine learning using Python. Right, so before we see the regression, we will see some fundamentals of machine learning. What is machine learning? And then we will switch to the regression, and we will see the examples, or examples how to use regression in the examples and how to predict the data. Right, so first of all, what is learning? Right, so the term is machine learning. So from that, what is learning? How we can define the learning? So many researchers has given the some different definitions of the learning. Right, so the first definition, let me share the pointer. Yeah, the first definition is learning denotes change in a system that enables a system to do the same task more efficiently the next time. Right, so learning denotes change in a system, and due to that change, you are doing the same task again and again, and gradually you are improving and you are achieving your final results. For example, if you are considering the little kid, if you are showing him the one, then first time if he is knowing, then he is telling that it is five. Again, you are showing that two, three times more, and then you are asking him, then he will give the answer correct. That means from the experience he learned that thing, and he grasped that this is, whenever this is the input or this is shown, it is the one. Right, similar way, if you see some figures like cat and dog, sometimes they misclassified, but you are showing the same thing number of times, then he come to know that this is the cat or the dog. Similar way, learning denotes change in a system. So in a computer system, first you are implementing some algorithms, you get some output, but it is not as the desired output. You are repeating the same thing with the different inputs. So you are gradually improving the system and you can achieve the desired output. Right, so that definition is given by Herbert Simon. The next definition is learning is constructing or modifying representation of what is being experienced. Right, so what is being experienced? According to that, you are learning something, and after that learning, you will decide or you come to some decisions. Then the third definition is learning is making useful change in our mind. Right, so obviously, learning is making useful change in our mind. Right, so once you are learning, there is the change in our minds. Right, so these are the few definitions of the learning. Then what is machine learning? Again, I have listed out two definition of the machine learning here. So machine learning means it's not like that you are giving the book to the, you are putting the book in front of the computer and computer is reading that book and computer will learn. It is not like that. So machine learning is concerned with computer programs that automatically improve their performance through experience, right? So machine learning is concerned with the computer program that automatically improve their performance through experience. Through experience means you are giving huge amount of input with some variations, and from that input, your computer programs or system will learn and it will improve themselves, it will improve themselves automatically. This is one of the definition of the machine learning. Another is a computer program is said to learn from experience E. Right, so this definition is given by Mitchell. It is one of the good book of the machine learning, author of the book. A computer program is said to learn from experience E with respect to some class of task T. Right, so it has assigned some task T and it has given some input. Input means experience, and you are repeating that procedure, so it will learn something from that input and it will perform its task better way. So task T and performance measure P. If its performance at task in T as measured by P improves with experience E. So it's denote that if you have the many experience, or you can say experience means input. So if you are giving many input to your system is learn more thing from that inputs, and due to that, its performance is increases, or you can get the desired performance from the system or the machine learning algorithm. Right, as intelligence require knowledge, it is necessary for the computers to acquire the knowledge. Right, as a human, as a students, if we are intelligent, then we require the knowledge. If we have the knowledge, then we can say that I am the intelligent in this field. Similar way, computer also required the knowledge, and based on that knowledge, your machine learning algorithm will learn and perform the and improves the performance of the algorithm. Then the traditional programming, if you see the traditional programming, what we are doing before the machine learning, so we have the data, we have the program, we are giving that thing as an input to the computer, and the computer will give us the output. This is the traditional programming. We have the data, we are doing some coding, we are writing some program. It is given to the computer and computer will give the output and we will verify whether it is desired output or not. But now in machine learning, we have the data and output. So we are giving these two things as input, data and output to the computer, and it will generate you the program, or we can say it will generate the model. Right, so we have the data, we have the output, we are giving that thing to the computer or system, it will generate the program or model for us. It is the machine learning. It is the machine learning. Right, so if you have any confusion, you can ask participants why machine learning and why there is need to learn the machine learning, why there is need to apply the machine learning algorithms. So the reasons are the recent progress in algorithms and theory developed by researchers, right? So you can say the recent progress in the algorithm. So many algorithms are there, and so many algorithms and theories are developed by the researchers. So to handle that things, to process that thing, we required some machine learning algorithms. The second reason is growing flood of online data. As you know, there are every day, or you can say every minute, there are huge amount of online data is generated. So to process that huge amount data, we required to apply the machine learning algorithms. Then computational power is available. Nowadays, the high computational power is available, hardware devices are available. So we can use the appropriate machine learning algorithms to get the desired output. The next reason is the budding industries. There are so many industries are growing, and to handle the data of that industries, again, we required the machine learning algorithm. So these are the few reasons why we learn the machine learning. ML means machine learning applications. As in the introductory part, the inauguration part, the Dinesh sir told that there are many applications. Dinesh sir list out few. There are many areas in which we can apply the machine learning algorithms. It is the image processing, computer vision, then manufacturing, diagnosis, medicine, speech recognition, bioinformatics, then gene expression, and so many more, right? So machine learning is the very popular among the researchers because it says use applications. Then what are the types of learning? Right, so we have seen the definition of learning. What is learning? Now, what are the types of the learning? So there are the four types of the learning: supervised or inductive learning. Another is unsupervised learning, semi-supervised learning, and reinforcement learning. So we'll see each. The supervised or inductive learnings, training data includes desired output. I think in the next slide it is there. Okay, fine. Then after we'll discuss brief, and then we will switch to the next slide. So training data includes desired outputs, right? So you have given the data and you have given the labels of that data. So training data includes the desired output. So you have the desired output. You have to give your training data to the machine learning model, and machine learning model will predict and give you the output, predicted output, we can say. Then we are comparing the predicted output and the actual output we have given, and from that we can decide the performance of the algorithm. So in supervised learning, we have given the labeled data. The outputs are already given. The second one is the unsupervised learning. So in unsupervised learning, training data does not include desired output. So you have given the training data, or you can say you have given the data set, but the data set is unlabeled. Labels are not given, so outputs are not given. So in that, so from the machine learning algorithm will form various clusters, and then it will decide the performance of the system. So in advance, we don't have the output in unsupervised learning. The next one is the semi-supervised learning. So training data includes a few desired outputs. So it semi-supervised means it's a mix of both the supervised and unsupervised. So you have given few data, labeled, few unlabeled. It is semi-supervised. Then reinforcement learning, rewards from sequence of action. So you are giving rewards from the sequence of action, right? So from the sequence of actions or from the output, you are taking the decision. It is, and according to that, you are modifying the parameter. So it is the reinforcement learning. So supervised learning, the algorithms include prediction, and classification, regression. These are the examples of the supervised learning. So these two terms are related, classification and regression. So regression works on the continuous values, while the classification works on discrete labels. Right, so for example, you are predicting the rainfall. It is the example of the regression. You have given the experience of the faculty members. You are predicting the salary of the faculty members. It is the example of the regression. That means it is continuous values, while classification has the discrete labels. So you have given the face, you are recognizing whether that person face is or not. It is the classification. You have given the tumor as an input, you are finding whether some disease is there or not, yes or no, then it is the classification. Right, so this is the difference between classification and regression. So unsupervised learning, the examples are the clustering, probability distribution estimation, finding association, and dimensionality reduction. These are the example of the unsupervised learning. Semi-supervised learning, we have given mix of both the supervised and unsupervised. In reinforcement learning, decision making robot or chess machines are the example of the reinforcement learning algorithms. Now you see this figure, we have given three different types of the figure. This is the figure for the supervised learning, this is for the unsupervised learning, and this is for the semi-supervised learning. So you see in the supervised learning, the labels are already there in the data sets or training data. While in unsupervised learning, you don't have the labels. It feels like all are the same data, but it will form the different clusters according to the characteristics of the data, and according to that cluster, it will take the decision. In the semi-supervised learning, it is mix of both the supervised as well as unsupervised learning. Then we have already discussed, then after we have given the figure for the supervised learning. In the supervised learning, we have the inputs and we have the outputs. Output means target data that we have, we acquire from the machine. Right, so we have the input, we have the output. We are giving that thing as a input to our supervised learning algorithm. Supervised learning algorithm will generate the model, or you can say it will train the model. Then from the model, you are giving some new input X. Here the X is given input, Y is given the output. So you can give some unknown data as input to the model, and it will give the predicted output. It will give the predicted output, or you can say the computed output. Then you are comparing this computed output and the desired, or we can say the actual output we have given. If the actual output and the computed outputs are similar or near, then you can say your model performance is good. If there are the huge difference between the computed output and the actual output, then you required to retrain the model, or you can say that your model performance is not good. Clear up to here, students? Any confusion, participants? I hope it is clear to all. Please, anyone reply?
Yes, sir. Yes,
okay, thank you. Yeah, thank you. The next is the unsupervised learning. So in the unsupervised learning, as we discussed, we have given the training data, or we can say the input data, but we have not given the output data. So in unsupervised learning, we have given the input data. That input data is given to the algorithm, and the algorithm will generate various clusters, and that input will fall in different clusters. And then you are giving the input to the model. It will fall if your input data is fall in the particular or appropriate cluster, then you can say that your algorithm's performance is good. If it will fall in the different clusters, then you can say that your performance your algorithm performance is not good. So you see here we have not given the output, so we cannot compare the model output with the actual output. So actual output is not given here. Then sometime we required in the last slide I told training set. So what is the training and testing set? So training and testing set, so whatever data, or you can say data set, we have given, we are dividing that data set into training set and testing set. So training set is used to train the model. Training set is used to train the model, and testing set is used to measure the performance of the trained model. So you are giving the test set data as input to the model, and your model will give the computed output. Then you are comparing that computed output with the actual output if we are using the supervised approach. Right, so training is the process of making the system able to learn. Right, so from the training data, your system is going to learn. So your model is learning. So you are training the model means your model is learning from the input data. Right, so training set and testing set come from the same distribution, or it may come from the different distribution. So it is not the rule that your testing set data must be from the training set data. It may be from the from outside the training set data, but if you are giving so many inputs in the training set data, then your model learn more and more from the input data. So there is the possibility that your model will give the good results. If you have the less training data, then there is the less chance for the model to learn from the input data. So it might be possible that you will not get the desired data. So it is the usual way that if we have the so many records in the training set, and using that training set you are trained your model, then there is the possibility that you will get the good performance of the model, because the model has learned so many things from the so many input data. The training set is used to find the performance of the trained model, right? So that we have discussed. Right, so this is the purpose for the training and test set. Right, so you have given the use amount of data, or you can say you have the data set. So you can split your data set into training and testing set. So your distribution is such that the training set has the more data compared to testing set. It is not the rule, but if training set has the more data, that means your model will learn more from the training set and it will give the good result. But you can take 70-30, you can take 80-20, 80 in training and 20 in testing, 70 in training and 30 in testing, likewise. Right, so training and testing set, again continue, we have given the things. We have given universal set, unobserved data, or you can say this is the data set. So from the data set you can split it into training set and testing set. So training set, there is the Here it is given the observed data, means the labels are given. So according to that, the data are distributed. Then we can say it is data acquisition. Then for the practical uses, we are using the testing data. You see the testing data, it is unobserved, right? So it's a mix of all the categories of the data, right? So it is unobserved. Here it is separated, right? So it is observed data. So it is not necessary that the testing set has the observed data. It is mixed, or it may, the data may be in the testing set from outside this data set. So whenever you are giving some unknown data as input to your model, then you can take the decision that whether your model give the best result or not. Because whatever be the data in the training set, you have given that data as a input to train the model. So the model is trained with that data. But if you are giving some unknown data, at that time you have to see what is the reaction of your model, whether it is give the appropriate result or not. If it will give the appropriate result, then you can say that your model is trained well. Now, I hope it is clear what is machine learning, what is the learning, what is machine learning, types of learning, and what is training and testing set. Is there any confusion up to here? If no, then we can start regression. If you have any confusion, please ask.
No, sir.
Okay, thank you. Now the next is, what is regression? Right, so regression we have seen in the second or third slide about classification and regression. So at that time I discussed that regression is used to predict the continuous values. Right, so regression is used to predict the value of a dependent variable based on the value of at least one independent variable. Right, so we can consider the equation of line equation that you have studied, the y equal to mx plus b, right? So in that we can say that y is the dependent variable and x is the independent variable. So according to x value, there is the change in the y value because y is the dependent value, right? Similar way here, predict the value of a dependent variable based on the value of at least one independent variable. It required at least one independent variable. There is the possibility that there may be more than one independent variable, that we will see. So explain the impact of changes in an independent variable on the dependent variable. So try to understand this graph. So on the x-axis we have given x independent variable, this is the input. In the y-axis, this is the dependent variable, right? So the regression shows the relationship between the dependent variable and independent variable. So if I am changing the values of the independent variable, there is the change in the dependent variable, right? So it is denoted by the regression. So if you are giving x as input, it will predict the y value, it will predict for the dependent variable, right? So x may be anything. If you are considering that hours for reading on x axis, you consider on y axis the grade. So if your hours in reading is increases, your grade should be increases, right? So the grades are depends on the hours of reading, how many hours you are reading per day. If you are reading more hours, obviously your grade will be increases, right? So it shows the relationship between dependent and independent variable. Why regression? Why we study the regression? Which kind of predictions can be done? So this is only, these figures are the only for attract you people, right? So regression, if you wish to predict the height of the, we wish to predict the height of the wife from the height of the husband. Then here some of the figures are given for the well-known persons. Its height is given, and from that you are predicting the height of the wife, right? So objective is to predict height of the wife in a couple based on husband's height. So you have given as input the husband height, and from that you are predicting the wife height, right? So the response, or you can say the dependent variable, is y, means the height of the wife, and the predicted variable is, or the independent variable or regressor variable, x, is the height of the husband, right? So you are inputting height of the husband here, and it will predict the height of the wife, right? So this is one of the example of the regression. Then the two terms, regression and correlation, both are very much nearer. So you should also know what is correlation. So correlation is used to measure strength of association between two variables, right? So correlation is used to measure the strength of association between two variables, how nearer or how associated these two variables. It is find out from the correlations. So correlation is only concerned with strength of the relationship. So it shows the strength of the relationship. If it is more associated, we can say there is a strong relationship. If there is less or weak associated, then we can say there is weak relationship. And this is one of the example. We can say this is all are the strongly associated points, or you can say variables. And this is the equation to find the correlation that we will see. Then the types of the regression. So the first type is the simple linear regression. Second one is the multiple linear regression, polynomial regression, and logistic regression, right? So these are the different types of the regression. So we will start with the simple regression, right? So the simple regression model, first, the simple linear regression means the straight line is used to predict the data, right? So now you see the equation, or you can, we can say the simple linear regression model equation. So yi equal to beta 0 plus beta 1 xi plus sigma I. So here yi is the dependent variable. Yi is the dependent variable. Then beta 0 is y intercept. Beta 0 is the y intercept. Then beta 1 is the slope. Beta 1 is the slope coefficient. And xi is the independent variable. So you are giving xi as input, and you are predicting y value, right? So you are giving xi as input to your linear regression model, and it will predict the value of y. Then plus sigma I, it is the random error term, or you can say random error component, right? So this is the equation for this. This is the y intercept. Beta 0, beta 1 will indicate the slope coefficient, and xi is the independent variable. And this error, we are considering it is nearer to 0, so it should be negligible. So whenever we are deriving the equation for the linear regression, we will neglect this. So in the next, we try to understand the regression model equation. So this point, this blue points, we have given that points. Then this line represent the predicted. It is the linear regression line, predicted points. So it will join the predicted points. Now you see this bit Yes, any confusion, participants? Hello, some noise is coming. Okay, so you see, okay, thank you, sir. You see the figure, as we have seen in this equation, this beta 0 is the y intercept. So this is the y intercept value beta 0. Beta 1 is the slope. So this is the, this will represent the slope, and ei, sigma I, is the error. So how to find the error, right? So that we have discussed in the supervised learning, that we have given the output, we are computing the output, and we are comparing the actual output and computed output. So similar way, here we have, this is, this dot represent the predicted value of y, and this is the observed value of y, means actual value of y. The difference between the actual and predicted is known as the error. So this is the error, this is the error, right? This is the xi value. So whenever you are giving xi as input, it will give the predicted value of y, and this line will represent the linear regression. Is it clear, participants? Any confusion to in understanding this graph?
No, sir.
Okay, fine. No, sir. Then we now will derive the equation for the linear regression. The simple linear regression equation provides an estimate of the population regression line. Right, so simple linear regression equation provides an estimate of the population regression line. So the equation for the linear regression is y i hat equal to b0 plus b1 xi. So here this y I hat represent the estimated or predicted y value for observation I, or you can say that this is y is the independent variable, x is the dependent variable, b0 is the y intercept, and b1 is the slope. B1 is the slope, right? So whenever you are giving xi, it will predict value for yi. Right, so if we wish to implement the linear regression, we have to find the terms given in this equation, because this is the equation for the linear regression. So we have to find b0, means y intercept, we have to find b1. We have given the xi and yi. From xi and yi, we have to find the b0, means y intercept, and the slope b1, right? So you have to remember this equation, and now we'll see how to find this y intercept and the b1. Okay, before that, the types of the relationships are given. So you see here, this is linear relation, this is the linear relation line, and which will predict the points nearer. This is, in this, the slope is positive, in this the slope is negative. This is curvilinear relationship. Then the strong relationship, all points are nearer to the regression line, and this is the, in this figure the slope is positive, in this figure the same figure is there, but whenever the slope is negative, this kind of output is there, and it is the strong relationship. This is the weak relationship when the slope is positive, and this is the weak relationship whenever slope is negative. So you see the figure, strong relationship, all points are associated, while all are the far away, they are weak associated. So we can say it's a weak relationship. Then the types of relationship, again, no relationship. So this will happen. This is the regression line when the slope is zero. When the slope is zero, and it will show the no relationship. Now the least square fit. We required to find the least square fit. So how to find the the line fitted by least square is the one that makes the sum of square of all vertical discrepancy as small as possible. This is the vertical discrepancy. Vertical discrepancy means it represents this error, because this Y4 is the actual output and this Y4 hat is the predicted output. So the difference between the actual and predicted, it gives the error. So if your model will give the best performance, if you are reducing this error as much as possible. If error is small, your model performance is high. If error is high, your model performance is low. And due to that, it is written that the line fitted by least square is the one that makes the sum of square of all vertical discrepancy as small as possible. The line which fits the best is called the regression line. The line which fits the best is called the, this line is called the regression line, or sometimes the least square line. So both are same. The line always passes through the points defined by X bar and Y bar, or you can say X bar and Y bar means the predicted points. Now, for example, you consider this sigma 4 equal to Y 4 minus Y 4 head. That means it is predicted. This is actual output. So you required to minimize this. You required to minimize this error, right? For all points, but it is, for example, only the E4 or Y4 is considered. So smallest square residual SSR, it is one of the major performance measure. SSR, smallest square residual, equal to sigma I equal to 1 to n sigma I square is minimum, right? So we have to minimize this. So SSR equal to minimum, then the sigma I equal to 1 to n, and then in place of this error term, we are writing this yi minus yi hat all raised to square. Then at minimum equal to again yi and yi hat, it is the equation for the line that we have seen in this slide. This, so from that it is written. Right, so it is B0 minus B1 xi all raised to square. Getting, so we have to minimize this. I am again in the next slide, the mathematics is given how to derive the terms for the B0 and B1. So I am not going in detail of this, but I hope this is clear to you. We require to minimize this error. Then after applying all this mathematics, we come to know that this is the final equation to find the B0. We have seen the linear regression equation, and that we required to find the B0 and B1. Right? So how to find the B0? The equation is B0 equal to Y bar minus B1 X bar. And this is the equation to find the B1. This is the equation to find the B1. So using this equation, we will find both B0 and B1, and by putting the value of B0 and B1 in this equation by putting the value of B0 and B1 in this equation, and we will put the value of xi, we will predict the value of yi, right? So we want to find the two unknown terms B0 and B1. So by using this formula, we can find the terms B0 and B1, and we will use that two terms in the linear regression equation. Right, so now we will see the simple linear regression example. So a real estate agent wishes to examine the relationship between the selling price of home and its size measured in square feet. So we have given the data sets of the house area and its selling price, right? So from the house area, we have to predict the price of the house. From the square feet area of the house, we have to the price of the house. So a random sample of 10 houses is selected. In that, the dependent variable y means it's a house price in dollar, and independent variable x means it's a area of house in square feet. Getting the definition, this problem statement, students, we will see the data set. In that, we have given the 10 records, or we can say we have given the two rows, two columns with the title house price and the area in square feet. So area in square feet is the independent variable, and the house price is the dependent variable. So we have to input the area of the price, and it will area of the house, and it will predict the price for the house using linear regression. Right, so these are the sample data we have given. So house price in dollar y and the square feet, this is the area of house, these are the values of the square feet. If the value is, this is in dollar, so you can multiply it, right? So 1400, it is the square feet area, and its price in dollar is 245, right? So this is not actual, but for the example I have considered that these values. Similar way for all square feet area, the house price is given, right? So now we have to predict, if I am giving this as an input to my linear model, what is the output? We have the actual output, we have the actual price, selling price of the house. Now we have to compute the predicted output of the linear model, and from that we will decide the accuracy, or you can say performance, of the model. Right, so this is the scatter plot of the data set we have given, or you can say values we have given. This is the square feet area, this is house price in dollar, and these are the values of the x and y axis, right? So this plot is draw from this value. Using this value, this plot is developed. Right, so now we will see the manual calculation, how we can do it, and then we will see the Python code to implement the linear regression. Any confusion up to here?
No.
Okay, so we'll see the example. I have put the hyperlink, so I will open it. Right, so you see we have given this two column, that house price in the font. I hope the fonts are readable, or need to increase the font size?
Yes, sir.
It is visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Right, so this is house price in dollar, and this is square feet. So this is the independent variable y, this is the dependent variable x. We required to find the values of B1 and B0. So for that we have seen the formula. So for that we have to find xi square. This is xi square, right? So I have put the formula, I think, right? So yeah, right. So it will find the xi square. This is yi square, means it will find the value of this. This is the multiplication of xi and yi, means first two columns, right? Then this will shows the sigma yi or sigma y. This is the summation of all entire row. So sigma y, this shows the sigma x. Then this shows the sigma xi square, sigma yi square, and sigma xi yi. Then this is the, what is this? This is y mean, or we can say y bar. So it is the sigma yi divided by total number of values. So it is 10, total number of records. So it is 10. So it will give me y bar. This is x bar. And now using these values, we are predicting the B1 and B0. In another example, I have computed so many things, right? So that we will see. So here, how to find the B1? So you see, though I have directly put the formula here because this is the manual calculation. In the Python, you have given the inbuilt model, or you can say package. So using that package, you can directly find this B1 and B0. So you see the formula. Before that, I switch to this. Yes, this is the formula to find the B1. This is the formula to find the B1. So using this, right, so you see using this, the E12 means it is the value sigma xi yi minus n means number of points into 1715, means it is x bar, and this 286.5 means it is y bar, bracket complete, divided by C12 means xi square, sigma xi square minus n is 10, then into B13 means it is the x bar into x bar means x bar square. So if you are putting this formula, it will find the value of B1. It is the B1 0.11, and the B1 represent the slope in the linear regression equation. So B1 represent the slope and B0 represent the y intercept. So now you have to find the y intercept using the formula. Y intercept equal to y bar minus B1 x bar. Y bar minus B1 x bar. Right, so formula y bar is the 286.5 minus b1.11 into x bar, so 1715. So if you are doing this, it will give you the value 9825. So now you have the value of b0 and b1. You can put this value in the linear regression equation, and then you can predict the new value for x, right? So we again, any confusion in this calculation?
No sir.
Okay, then we switch to the next. This is the scatter plot, or you can say the graphical representation. Now you see we have received the value b0 is 98.24. Okay, let me check. Yes, 98.25. Here it is given to 4. 98.24. and it is 0.11. So it is same, right? So it will put this value house price means predicted equal to B0. Let me on the pointer. Right, so this is B0 plus B1. B1 represent the slope 0.11 or you can say 0.109 in square feet. Then this is the y intercept and this is the slope and this line will represent the linear regression. Right, so that we will see how to predict the value. What are the values of the prediction? Whenever we will see the implementation again, for the sake of simplicity, I have put one slide. If you wish to predict the house price for the area of 2000 square feet, then you can put that value in the regression equation. We have derived this regression equation, right? So here we have to put in place of xi, we have to put the value of x means 2000 and it will predict the value of $317.85. Now we will see if it is 2000 is there in the, 2000 is not there, but if it is 2325, then it is 405, right? So we can say it's nearer. Right, so this is the way you can predict the values, and then you can plot the scatter plot and you can draw the linear line to represent the predicted values, and you can find the errors and you can find the accuracies. For how to measure the model performance, so for that we are using these three terms, SST, SSR and SSE. So SST is the total sum of square, SSR is the regression sum of square, or you can say sum of square regression. In some of the book it is written sum of square regression, and SSE it is sum of square error, or error sum of square. If you are reading like this, then sum of square error, and this is sum of square regression. So SST is the sum of square total, right? So how to find out that value? So for that you required to find the SSR, SST first, you required yi minus y bar whole raised to square, SSR equal to sigma yi hat. Yi hat means it is predicted value, minus y bar whole raised to square. Then SSE equal to sigma yi minus yi hat square. So we can say if you are simplifying that, then SST equal to SSR plus SSE, right? That's why it is written. So once you find the SSR and SSE, you can find the SST. Here y bar is the average value of the dependent variable, means mean of y. Yi is the observed value of the dependent variable. Observed means actual value that we have given. And yi hat means it is the predicted value of y for the given value of xi. Right, so using this you can find these three terms, SSR, SSE and SST, and from that you can measure the performance of the model. So that we will see. So again, this what this will represent, measure of the variation. So I'm not discussing in much more because we have less time, and we require to see the implementation. Then you see this is will represent the measure of variation. This is the y bar and you are computing, this is the predicted points. So SST is the yi minus y bar. So this is yi minus y bar. So it will give you the SST. Then SSE, sum of square of error, it equal to sigma yi minus yi hat square. So yi this point will represent yi, this point will represent the yi hat. So it will give you the SSE. Then SSR, sum of square of regression, it is the yi hat means this point, and y bar means this. So difference, it will represent the SSR. So you see, this is SSE, this is SSR, and you see this graph. So it will SST equal to, you can say SSE plus SSR, this previous to previous, this SST equal to SSR plus SSE, right? So from this graph, you can say that SST equal to SSE plus SSR. I hope this is clear.
Yes.
No, any yes, confusion? First student say yes or no. I don't listen properly.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine, good. Then one more term used to find the accuracy of the, or you can say performance of the model. It is the coefficient of determination, R square. R square is known as the coefficient of determination. The coefficient of determination is the portion of the total variation in the dependent variable that is explained by variation in the independent variable. So you can say that it will represent the accuracy of the model. The coefficient of determination is called R squared and is denoted by R square. So if you wish to find R square, you must have to find the SSR and SST. So R square equal to SSR divided by SST. R square is the sum of square of regression and SST is sum of square total. And here the not is given. The R square value should be between 0 to 1. If the R square value is nearer to 1, then you can say that your model performance is best. If it is 1, you can say your model performance is 100%. That means if it is nearer to 1, you can say your model performance is good. If your value of R square is less than the, I can say less than 50, then you can say your model performance is not good. It is 50 below the 50%. Right? I hope it is clear. Right, so now we'll see the Python code for the regression. Right, so first of all, we will discuss this, that we have discussed how to find these two, and then we will switch to the another code. Hello, my Jupyter notebook is visible to you, students?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Right, so for the implementation, I have used the Jupyter notebook. If you are comfortable with Jupyter notebook, you install Jupyter notebook, or you install the Anaconda package. It is inbuilt in the Anaconda package. Or if you are not comfortable with this, you can use any of the editor. You can use IDLE, you can use Spider, you can use PyCharm, Jenny, any of the editor which is comfortable to you, but you required to install the required packages. While in Anaconda, it is already installed. So if you are using the Jupyter notebook or you are using the Spider, then there is no need to install the extra packages because most of the packages are installed. Right, so here I am using the pandas. So I have import pandas as PD. I import numpy as NP. So pandas is for the statistical analysis package. Numpy is to work with the multidimensional arrays. Then import matplotlib.pyplot as PLT. So matplotlib is used to draw or develop various plots. And this percentage matplotlib inline, so it will develop various graph in whenever in execution. right? So these are the libraries, or you can say packages you required to import. Then if to run, you have to select this, you have to run. If it will not give any error, that means that packages are import successfully in your program. Then we required to load the data set. So I have loaded already the, I have put that data set here in this regression example here. Salary, house price, yes. Right, this is the line. So we have given the two column, price and area. This is the CSV file. Right, so we have given the CSV file at this path. C user, admin, desktop and regression PPT. Right, so I have given the complete path. So DF is the variable equal to PD, as the we have import pandas as PD. So PD dot read CSV. So read CSV is the function to read the CSV file, and then you have to give the complete path. So it will read the CSV file. And if I am writing DF, then it is similar to print the content of DF. Right, so I am running this, so it will show me the data set. Okay, why it gives the error? Because I have prepared that code at my in my laptop, and right now I am using my desktop at college. So the path are different. Using instead of users, here it is admin. Now let's check. Yeah, right. So now it run. You see it shows the data sets. By default, it shows this index 0 to 9 means total 10 records. Then this is the price of the house. This is the area of the house. If this is the area of the house, then this is the price in dollar, right? So it is denoted by the DF will show that thing. I am making it common, and if I am running, then it will be removed. Now I want to draw the scatter plot for the available data set. So I have to label the x-axis. So PLT dot x label equal to square feet, and PLT dot y label equal to price in dollar. Then PLT dot scatter, so it will plot, it will do the scatter plot of DF dot area comma DF dot price. So these are the DF dot area and DF dot price. This is the independent variable. Then color equal to red and marker equal to plus, right? So it will do, it will draw the graph. This hash is used for the comment. So now if I am running this code, it will draw the same graph, right? So this is x-axis, this is y-axis. X-axis shows the square feet, area in square feet, and this will show the price in dollar. Now as in the presentation, I have discussed the correlation. Correlation will decide how the points are associated with, right? So how the points are associated with each other. It is denoted by the correlation. So if I am finding the correlation, then directly inbuilt function is there. So print df dot core r. So if I am running this, it will give me the value of correlation, right? So it will give me the value, this value 0.76. Right, so 76% points are related, right? So we can say the points are not too much related, so we will not get the much accuracy of this model, right? Then after importing the data set, after plotting the scatter plot for the data set, we will now import the model. So in the next, I am importing the regression model. So import sklearn. Sklearn is the inbuilt package in that the linear model is available. So sklearn dot linear model as lm. So as lm I am importing the linear model. Then I am creating the linear model object. So lr equal to lm dot linear regression. So it will create the linear model object LR. Then I am writing x equal to df. Df is our data frame. So df dot area, and it will do it in the column colon, and np dot np is our numpy, np dot new axis, right? So it will convert this to the array, right? So whatever be the values we have seen here, okay, I call df, let me run, right? So area will come to this, and this is the price, right? So x equal to area, because x is the independent variable and y is the price. So df dot price dot values, and then lr dot fit xy. So fit xy means you are training your model with the training data or the input data, right? So using lr dot fit, you are giving training to your linear regression model. So x and y is the dependent variable, and x is the area, means it is the independent variable, right? So your model will be trained. Now I am running this, right? So you see it will give this output, linear regression, copy x equal to true. That means your model is trained successfully. Now we required to find the b0 and b1. We required to find the b0 and b1. So the value, if you wish to find, the inbuilt function is there, lr dot intercept underscore, and lr is our regression object, the regression model object. So lr dot coefficient underscore, right? So it will display the intercept and coefficient. So it will find both b0 and b1. We are comparing this with our computed values. Anyway, now you see the b0 is 98.25 and b1 is 0.11. This is our manual computation, and this is computed by the model, right? So it's same, right? Hello. Right, so it's same. Now I have tried to find in the PPT, I have put this example. If you wish to find the where is that is, yes, this example, right? So you can find for the 2000. So it is 317.85. I have put that thing here. I have put the equation. Now I am running, and we'll see the output, what it will predict. So it will predict, our model predict 317, and here it shows the 317.85. Here it shows the 317.78. So it's almost similar. Now we are predicting LR dot predict X. So X is our area in square feet. We have given the actual price. Now we are giving this as an input to our model, and we will predict the selling price from the model. I hope up to any clear, any doubt up to here, students?
No, sir.
Okay, right. So now LR.predictX. So LR.predictX means, X means our entire area from the data set, right? So if I am putting X and try to print the value of X, then it shows the area. This will shows the areas. So we are giving this all as a input to the model to predict the value of selling price, right? So we are giving the LR dot predict X. So I am running this. Right, so this is the output. Now if I want to compare this with the actual output, then I can insert cell below. I am here, insert cell below. Okay, fine. Now if I am writing Y, then Y represent my actual selling price. So right, so you see, you can compare, this is the actual, this is the actual, and this is the predicted by the model, this is predicted by the model. So whenever the area is 1400, the actual selling price is $245 and the predicted is $251.92. similar way, whenever the price is 312, here the predicted is 273. Here the predict actual is 279, the predicted 284. There are the some difference in the actual and prediction. That means there is the error, right? So whenever you are finding the accuracy of the model, we will see that thing, right? So this is the predicted X. We can compare it with the actual output. Now we are plotting the scatter plot and the linear regression line. So you can see the PLT dot scattered XY color equal to black. So then PLT dot plot X and linear predict X. So this is the X value in square feet and this is the input you are giving and it will predict the new values. Color equal to blue and line width is given 3. Then it will give the X label, Y label and title. So if I am running, right, so you see it will give the regression line. There is use error between the this line represent the predicted points and these are the actual points, this black. So there are the use error. There are so many error here, this point, this will represent the error, this will represent the error. Right, so now that is fine. I am adding this new predicted value to the new CSV file. So my predict.csv will new file will be created and the predicted value will be inserted. Now I want to find the R square that we have seen here. R square SSR divided by SST. So if R value is nearer to 1, we can say the model is well trained. So from sklearn dot matrix import R2 underscore score and it will find the R2 underscore score by Y and DF dot predicted. Y is the selling price and this is the predicted price. So we are finding the difference between this predicted and selling price and it will give me the accuracy. So if I am running, okay, because I have not created this df dot predicted, this predicted is not created. So if I am running this first, now I am running, right, so it will give me 0.58%. That means the accuracy of this model is 58%. Accuracy of this model, okay. The another example that I have considered is the grade exercise, right? So you have given the hours of reading and you have given the grade. So you see here this two is given, that hours and grade. So grade is the dependent variable, X hours is the independent variable. If 2 hour reading per day is there, then the grade is 57%. If 3 hour, then 66%. If 10 hour, then there may be the year. It is assumed that the grade is 100%. Right, so these two things you have given and you have to find the linear regression among the points and you have to predict the new values. So this is the manual computation that I have done. This is XI square, this is YI square, this is XI YI. This is grade predicted. After considering this, I have find the sigma XI, sigma YI, then mean of X, mean of Y. This is sigma XI square, sigma YI square, sigma XI YI. Then using this, I have find out the B0 using this formula. Right, so this will find, then using B0 and B1, you have to find this, because by putting B0 and B1 value in the regression model, you can find the predicted values. So it will find the predicted values. I have put the formula, so it will find the predicted values B1, B0 and X. So it will find the predicted values. Here I have find out the error. It is the actual output and the predicted output. So actual output is Y and the predicted output is Y hit. So, right, so if 2 were reading is there, then at that time it will show grade 57 is actual, but model shows 59.71. Right, so it will show the error. So I have find out the error for all the computed and the actual output. Then I have find out the SSE, sum of square of errors, sum of square of error. So it will find out the SSE. Then I have find out the Y hit minus Y mean, because we required this value to find out the SSE and SSR. So I have find out Y hit minus Y mean. Then I have find out the SSR, sum of square of residual, means the square. Then I have find out SST. As you know, SST is the SSR plus SSE. So it is SSE plus SSR. So it will give SST. Then this is the sigma SSE, total value of SSE. This is SSR. And this will represent the SST. Then I have computed the R square, means it gives the accuracy 97%, 97.5%, means it's good accuracy compared to previous model. Previous model shows the only 58%. Right, so is it clear? Any confusion in this manual calculation? Students?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Okay, now. Now we'll see the code for this. Right, so I have imported the same libraries. So again, I am going to run. I have read the data set, which has two columns. I will uncomment this, so it will list out the data columns. Right, so you can see the value of the data columns, data frames. So it shows hours and grades. Now this code will plot the graph, and find the correlation. So it will find, you can see the graph. The points are linearly associated, so you can say that you can draw the linear line or linear model will represent based this point. And you see the correlation, it shows 98%. That means the strong association is there among the data points. Then from the similar to previous code, I have retried the or import the sklearn from the sklearn library, import the linear model as LM, then create the linear model object LR, then X, I have indicate X equal to the independent variable hours, Y is the dependent variable, means grade, and I have trained the model using LR.fit XY. Right, so if I am running this, it will give me the this thing. That means my model is trained successfully. Now using these two, we can find B0 and B1, intercept and coefficient. So it will find the intercept and coefficient. It is 49.67 and 5.01. Then I am predicting the value of X. So it will predict the value of x. Now my y is the actual value. So if I wish, I can insert here new column. I can print the value of y. Right. So you see, whenever the grade is 57, the predicted shows 59. Whenever it is 66, predicted shows 64.72. Whenever 73, it shows 69. Whenever 76, it shows 74.75, means around 75. Right, so it's 79, it shows 79. 81, it shows 84. 90, it shows 89. 94.82, it shows 96. Likewise, right, 99.84, and here it shows 100. So it's nearly related. Then this graph will plot the regression line. And as you can see, the regression line will represent the most of the points, and there is less error. Only this is the error, this is small error, and here is the small error. These 3 points only shows the error. Compared to this, if you see the previous example, there are so many points shows the error. Right, so now I am exporting whatever predicted value. I am adding that predicted value to new CSV file. So df.2_CSV will create the new CSV file. So I'm running this code. And now I am finding the accuracy of the model. So it will find the accuracy. Right, so it will show the 97.57, and our predicted shows 90.9757, manual computation. And this will also gives the same. That means we have our model is well trained and will give the good accuracy. Similar way, you can try for the another things at homework. It is okay, it is not here, it is there here. You can try for salary. So you have given the number of experience and you have to predict the salary of the employee. You have to predict the salary of the employees. So in that we have given the many records, 30 records are given. So here it is possible you can split that data set in train and test. Right, so you can do this exercise at home. And I think it's enough from my side. Thank you from my side. Now, if you have any confusion, you can ask.
Let me say a few words related with this webinar. Actually, I attended the webinar, entire webinar, and it was explained by him, by our expert, Dr. Uday sir, very well. He has started with very beginning, like what is learning. Then he has given three definitions of learning. Then after, he has explained what is machine learning, right? Then different type of the machine learning ways, like supervised machine learning, unsupervised learning, semi-supervised machine learning, then reinforcement learning. And he has explained very well each type of the learning. Then he has moved to supervised learning with classification and regression and prediction. He has explained all these type of the methods of supervised learning. Then in that again, he has gone in a deeper and started with what is regression and what are the different applications of regression, and where some, you know, the definition of the regression with the diagrams, like the relationship with the dependent variable and independent variable. Then he has also explained what is error in case of machine learning model, and how to minimize, or we can say what is the importance of minimizing the error in case of this regression or any other kind of machine learning. If we minimize the error, then we can always have a better accuracy in the our future testing or in the prediction. He has explained very very nice way with the couple of examples in Excel, calculations manually in Excel, and then after he has worked with Python, what are the different libraries or we can say packages that we can include in Python, right? Like you can include with Jupyter, you can include pandas, you can include numpy, you can use plot library to represent your data in a graphical way. And then after he has explained very nicely that some couple of examples like price area and price and some examples like grade and reading hours and all. So I really thankful Uday sir. So all the students got the concepts very well. So I on behalf of the IT department and information techno this Santilal Sai Engineering College, I really thankful to you all. Okay, and especially thank to the Uday sir to give the valuable time for us.